Are you mic'd up?
I am mic'd up. You ready?
Are you ready?
Born ready.
Born ready.
Today we're doing it. We got two mics. Well, we've got two mics that
yes.
I'm going to sync up and make sure that that works. And then we've got the room mic.
Old Faithful.
Old Faithful. And then we're going to be adding some lights next week if we need them. But we look amazing.
Yeah. Well, awesome. I hope everyone else agrees with us.
Do you agree?
Everybody else is like, well, lights might not be a bad move for them.
So
here's how we'll know. Typically, we get cookies and treats and stuff. If a whole rack of lights show up in the next week,
that's a problem.
We'll know that people are maybe not as taken with our
don't send lights
appearance.
We have lights
and like makeup kits.
Yeah. New hosts. Two new people. Like, can you just feed them lights?
Right, right.
Because
little puppets.
They're like models.
All right, we just do what we do. We do the best we can, all right?
All right.
With what we got. Jump into this?
Yes.
Okay, so quick stuff. We always like to check in with what's happened in the week. Hello, Junior. You can't see me, he's off camera. Old man doodles. He's doing great, so that's good
great.
Week. Junior, like, he hit his 15 and a half mark, and he's like, I'm coming back.
Yep.
Gus?
Gus went home.
Gus went home. Not that I didn't love him, but boy, is it nice to have
Junior.
Junior, get out of here. That big monster out of our hair.
Junior.
He's determined to knock over the camera
and get slime all over my new camera pack.
And then end up on a barbecue somewhere. Compliments to Laura.
Exactly.
Gus was a real challenge. Big, dangerous guy, and we had him for 3 weeks. So every potty break was fraught with,
fear.
Well, not fear, but just the knowledge of, like, you got a 130-pound dog that's bitten people before multiple times. Like, how are we feeling on this potty break? are we good? Me and you good? And he's not a big fan of, like, he's more of like
silent. He's the silent type.
Yeah, the strong silent type. And so I'll be enjoying, like, being able to relax back into life a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. Your backyard back.
Yeah. And he was, so I'm really proud of the accomplishment. That's all fantastic. And his mom's doing great. But, boy, his shedding and stuff like that, woo, and his drooling, boy, can he put a big hurt on the cleaning situation. So, anyways, so Gus is gone, went home. He's headed back to New Mexico today. Big props to his mom for doing a lot of great work and a big turnaround on herself. All my hands are present and accounted for, which I'm really pleased about.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's it, unless you've got something. Have you done new nails? Have you...
How sexist, like, out of
I was conquering wild beasts, and...
Have you done your nails?
Have you done your nails? Any laundry get done? Any ironing or anything like that?
Did you have any new recipes you came up with?
Did you whip up anything in the kitchen? No, I know that you've been nail-centric lately.
Oh, yeah.
You shared with the audience that getting your nails done, it actually helped, was kind of your hack at not chewing your nails anymore. And they're right here on my face, and they're bright red, so
they're
just
beautiful.
Figured I'd touch in. Because, if you don't mention nails and they're new...
Yeah, it's a problem. Yeah.
It's curtains for you.
No, I went camping with my family. It's kind of a manly type.
Yeah. You know, look at that. I didn't think to ask about that. Did you skin any bears or anything?
I had car trouble. I even opened my hood and, like, replaced the coolant.
Just to cry in
and
it.
And, like...
Open your hood.
No. I was very proud of all of the car trouble things that I worked out.
The antics and how you worked through it. You had a lovely couple help you out.
Yep, I sure did.
A couple of angels showed up and...
A couple of angels showed up and helped me fix a hose that came loose on my car in the 110-degree heat on the way up there.
With Hercules with you, too.
With Herc there, and I was in a place where I had no service except, like, light tech service, so that was interesting, and that's a place that my parents have gone. They went for 20 years before they had us kids. Not 20 years, I guess 10 years. because
they were only together. I think your parents would be 110 years old,
right? and then you took us kids us our whole lives. So.
What's the name of that place?
Jackass Meadows.
I was going to say, I knew it was like Jackass or something like that.
Jackass Meadows. So that was really fun.
Yeah.
All the kids and all my family all got together, so that was really neat.
And Hercules got to romp and play and do all the like fun doggy stuff.
You know what we should add? A Cujo countdown. Cujo, my new dog that some of you might know about.
Belgian Malinois
that's mine, but not really here yet. He's coming in July.
He's on a layaway plan.
He really is.
He's been laid away a long time ago.
He'll be here in July, so that's awesome.
Yeah.
So I don't know the exact dates. We can't do like a Cujo countdown official, but let's just say July is the countdown.
Yeah,
so
which
in
is what,
two,
couple
in
weeks?
Two Q&A Saturdays, we'll probably...
He might be sitting right here. Can you imagine?
I can't.
And he's like a big goofy guy. He'll be like this.
I just can't wait for him. I can't wait.
He's a sweetie pie. Yeah.
All right.
Awesome. All right, so camping was good, and I think that's it. I don't think we've had anything else. I think I'm stalling.
I'm just nervous
to get into the questions. So I'm stalling.
Let's
all right,
do it.
Let's jump in. All right. Hey, everybody. It's Sean from The Good Dog. And this is the lovely Laura Morgan. And this, all this good stuff, is The Good Dog's Q&A Saturday. I always have to glance down. Episode number 37. Do I do it?
Yep. That's
first,
it. That first, doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter?
No, because it's seven.
Okay,
I'm
cool.
I'm the three. You're
cool.
The seven.
So,
I don't know why we even do that anyway.
Because we're lame and cheesy. That would be, if I had a buzzer.
No one needs to see our fingers.
Our first question is from Miss Kandice K,
yes.
Which we've, and I don't know if you want to watch, she sent us a video. She's one of the first folks to actually send a video.
Oh, yeah?
So I don't know if you want to watch it or if you want me to just roll with it.
Let's just roll with it.
Okay.
Just roll.
Okay.
Maybe I can link it up here.
Maybe you can just add your two cents without even saying it. I really think roll up on the e-collar.
So question number one, this is from Kandice K. She says, hi, Sean and Laura, you are the best.
Aw.
It's been a long time. I still love you too. So my question this week is a video question. I'm not sure if you'll do that, but if you're down, I'll put the YouTube link at the bottom. Okay, so my question is about dog social skills behavior. We've discussed Cora, the dog police, before, and this is one of the policing things with her that I can't seem to figure out. Because of all the foundation work that I've been doing, plus a lot of duration place work, Cora is becoming a lot more tolerant of other dogs playing around her and being in her space. However, sometimes I still have to share info with her by using the remote. Cora doesn't know how to play with other dogs, and she wasn't properly socialized, so I've been trying to get her to create a bubble instead of getting upset at the other dogs and advocating for her space. So the video is what happens when I don't do a good job advocating space and don't correct early enough. Basically, Deji gets too far away from me, my invisible boundary line, so I call him to me.
Yep.
Cora chases him. 2 seconds later, he realizes it. He gets excited, starts running around, and then she always ends up lunging at him. So
it's a vicious cycle. It is.
Yep. Cool.
Okay, so I watched the video a couple times. Thanks for sending the video. Anybody else who wants to send a video in, that's really cool, and it's definitely super helpful. We can get a lot more insight. I think that Kandice just created a little YouTube video and then just linked it straight in from YouTube. So you guys, anybody's got anything that they want more specifics on?
We can also do a Dropbox thing if you guys don't want to put it on a private YouTube or whatever. You could Dropbox it to us, and we can actually hook it up there.
Awesome.
So we can show the folks.
Full service joint here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so... one, I love that both your dogs are on e-collars.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
That's Kandice.
So, I know, but it's just typically it's going to be if I was talking to not awesome people like our crew, it would be well, first you got to get your dog on the e-collar and da-da-da-da-da-da, because then you can actually do some work. So I just wrote a few notes down for you. So it's just awesome that they're on the remote, because it gives you so many opportunities to address this. And I know you're already addressing it. And it sounds like you articulated pretty good what was going on, which was getting a little behind the dogs, not correcting early enough, and then they're kind of playing off each other arousal-wise, and then it ends up in this whole kind of this... are you watching the video right now?
No, I'm just writing her question down.
kind of this, because you didn't get to see it, but basically it turns into some high level antics, and then they kind of circle each other, and there's tension, and then one like, kind of like, you know, does some stuff like that, just some snotty business. But the cool news is, like, the main thing I got was that, one, your dogs are well trained, they're listening, which is great, and they're both mild. It's all like pretty easy stuff, which is really good news. But I think it's just a real simple thing. I'd love to see you go after them earlier and a little more firmly with your e-collar corrections. Mm-hmm. It sounds like you're doing more verbal reminders, and I'm not sure if there were e-collar corrections with all of those verbal reminders, but there was more talking to them. And basically, as soon as you see, you know them so well, as soon as you see that, like, you recall the one dog, right? He starts moving, he's doing the right thing, and I think it's Cora that's coming behind chasing him, and she's worked up, just right there, correct her, right? And then if you don't get the correct verbal out, just give her a little pop on the e-collar, and that will slow her roll big time. Mm-hmm. And then say you don't. Say, like, what goes down in the video goes down again, in that she comes up chasing him. You just give pop, pop, each dog, right? Both dogs are a little, we're not talking about massive corrections, but each dog's just aroused. They're just like, they're being goofy and like kind of getting snippy with each other. And a quick tap for each dog would really just like,
just checks them in.
Yeah. So if they were my dogs and I called them over and that ensued, and especially if I knew it was kind of a game that typically goes on, first I would try and make sure that I'm catching whoever's the instigator right out of the gate. But then beyond that, it doesn't matter. If, say, you missed the instigating moment, whoever's aroused, correct them. And even if one was like just reacting or reflecting what was going on, it doesn't matter. You're just, like Laura said, checking them both in. You're just saying, like, hey, everybody, relax a little bit. Because when you're not relaxed, you get all pesky with each other. And then someone like Cora tries to like kind of like nip at the end. And once again, it's not severe stuff. It's snotty stuff more than anything, right? So they get aroused and then they get less polite. Just like kids wrestling, right? You get a couple kids wrestling and next thing you know, like the headlock's a little too tight, If somebody doesn't block it, then like an all-out fight ensues. So I would go e-collar a little more firmly, and I wouldn't, and I'd get off the verbal reminders. And I would, as soon as you see the arousal, don't be panicky. Don't be just calm and cool like you were in the video. But just like, if you get a verbal out, no. Yeah, I mean, if you want to say, Cora, no. Pop.
Dresdy.
It's a weird name, right? You know, pop.
Deji.
But, Deji. Yeah. But even if you don't get a verbal out, just the correction alone will absolutely, your dogs are conditioned to the collar. They're going to know what you're looking for. So all I saw were two dogs that were allowed, even beyond the initial moment that you missed, to continue to cycle and get into each other's space. And if you would have corrected at any of those moments at a decent enough level, you should have been able to inhibit that cycle, regardless of like where it started or what other moment you might have missed. So e-collar a little more firmly, early if you can help it, but if you can't get to it early, get to it as soon as you see the arousal and just address it. I think what you'll find is, if you're a little more on top of that and a little firmer with that, I think you'll see them start to do that less and less. If the corrections are really mild, what you might see is that the arousal kind of trumps the correction, and so they kind of just work through it. So that there's that game always of like, do we create an inhibition with a little firmer level, or do we nag and manage them with lower levels? And the managing and the nagging can be kind of a pain in the rear, because that just means the behavior just goes and goes and goes. So I've
just
said,
just check them in. It's like, it's sometimes because you're so good with this stuff, like you may just be just missing little thing, and I think that little thing is just knock it off. I think people, especially really really good owners that know e-collar really well, they tend to get like, well, is that fair, is it clear,
is it clear, which
is totally understandable. But it's very clear that when they feel that sensation, that they know that they're not supposed to be doing something, right? And they already know that state of mind, that's not okay, because you've been teaching them that. So just giving that little tap, and then they're like, oh, cool, all right. Well, and they'll probably like go sniff something or kind of like, oh yeah, I wasn't even like.
Because you just break the chain. Mm-hmm. So like Laura said, I mean, the perfect thing you said was checking them in.
Yeah.
Really, be like, if your kids were messing around and you just said, hey.
Knock it off.
And then they like, come down just a little level. Yep. So you need to do that a little bit higher levels and don't care about who instigated. And like Laura said, well, it's not fair because Dresdy was the on the loot. No. If Dresdy's revved up or Judgy, then just correct them both and get them both to relax. Yeah. Don't overthink it. It's a piece of cake. You've been fair training them. Time to lay down the law and get rid of this policing monkey business.
Yeah.
Cool.
Cool. Okay, we've got question number two. This is from Jaquelyn Warbis. Mm-hmm. Jaquelyn says, "Hey, Sean and Laura, loving the e-collar to transition from prong to off-leash, and it's working well."
Awesome.
Great. "My most recent rescue foster is a little Whippet Pit Mix, 11 months old. Perfect candidate for the e-collar. She's high energy, nervous, anxious, and fearful. She barks at the fence at small noises in the house when we're all enjoying quiet time. It could be something as simple as one of the other dogs moving their feet on the crate. Mm. I'm doing some of Laura's lockdown."
Is that trademarked or something?
I'll take it. Trademark that. "When she's not working and learning and she's very vocal in the crate, she has duration placed pretty well, waiting for food and all the other foundation work. I introduced her to the e-collar with short distance recall in place. She works at a very low level. I've kept the collar on when not working to take advantage of being able to correct some of the other behaviors. Mm-hmm. With the collar in place, she's a calm, cool, collected dog, and as soon as it's removed, the negative behavior returns." Okay, I've kept the collar. Okay. "I have left it on, moving it as you recommended, and no opportunity to correct suggestions." Okay, cool. I like these questions because these are like, they're easier for me. Go ahead.
Yeah. So basically, she's got this nervous dog that's, you know, we see tons of these, and as soon as I see this question, I just kind of like in my mind, I picture all the dogs that we have. Dog that comes through here is in that exact mode. Mm-hmm. And so we put the e-collar on and we start correcting for all that stuff to start inhibiting all of those cycles and all those habits and start to get rid of that stuff. Now, like you said, the challenge is that this dog is getting collar wise, and so when you take the collar off, it's giving you different behavior, right?
Correct. Yep.
So now, if we get a dog that comes in like that, that, you know, we work through the stuff, but then we take the collar off to give the dog's neck a rest, and the dog goes right back to it, then we're going to leave the collar on. So,
and she says she's done that, but now she doesn't have the opportunity to correct because she's leaving the collar on, but now the dog's been great. So she's like, she's not sure if it's like, you know, she's not, go ahead.
So I hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
Got it. But the thing is, that's great if you don't have to correct, because what's happening is you're patterning behavior. The whole trick to this stuff is to do stuff so long that dogs forget about what they used to do.
Exactly.
Right? So if it's barking at, like, say it's a dog that comes in for being like nervous barking at anything that goes by the house or in the yard or whatever outside of the crate, then the whole trick is to inhibit that barking long enough to where the dog forgets that that's the habit that they used to do. And they may not even know why they do it. They just, in nervous reaction, it's just cycled and cycled. So that would be the main focus I'd like to share with you, is just going after this in a consistent fashion, and that it will eventually just dissipate, but it's kind of a war of attrition. And even if you're not correcting, you're getting, I guess what I'm trying to say is, even if you're not correcting, you're getting value out of that moment, because the dog's not doing the behavior. And it's just like us, you know, they say it takes 21 days to create a new habit, something like that. I don't know what that translates to in dog world, but it's really just about inhibiting those things. That's why we're so big on, when dogs go home with owners, that, I know, you know, owners might say, like, can we let the dog be out in the backyard unsupervised, you know, when we go to work or something like that? And the reason we're so opposed to that is because dogs practice negative habits, stress-loading, adrenaline-loading habits in your absence, and they just cycle and cycle and cycle, and there's no one there to inhibit it. Mm-hmm. And so those habits just get built and built and built, and it becomes, you know, another big thing that they're trying to struggle with, and then they contact us and, whoa, you know, something's going on. And so that's basically because a habit's not getting inhibited or not getting controlled. So, blah, 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 blah.
And also, really quick, if I can, so she, I don't know how long it's been. Even if it's been 6 months, the dog still could be, just wait. I mean, my assumption is she's new, so I assume it's probably maybe been a month. Like, she's going to forget that collar's on, trust me, especially if she's been wearing it a lot. So the whole thing is you're looking like, how can I correct the behavior? How can I work with her if she's not, if she's just going to be like, oh, I'm good because this is on. Trust me, it'll come out. So
what do you mean it'll come out?
Those behaviors, like anything that she's not doing because the collar's on, she'll forget the collar's on and she'll still do those behaviors. So you will get a chance to correct. Mm. You know what I mean? Mm.
Yeah, and just to go back to that point, because I don't know if I made it clear enough, was that even if you're not getting to correct, that's great. If you're not getting to correct, that means that the dog isn't practicing the behavior, and it's probably not practicing the behavior because the e-collar's on, and so the concept of that there's a consequence for that behavior is causing the dog to not make that choice.
Yep.
So while that's transpiring, really great progress is happening, mm-hmm. even if you're not actively doing anything. What I'd suggest is that you get a comfort pad. I don't know what e-collar you're using, but if you're using one of these guys, these little mini educators, I would get a comfort pad that goes on it, and it actually dissipates the pressure, or I should say generalizes or expands the pressure from two contact points to four, like more of like a little like oval kind of like quad thing. And basically it's easier on the dog's neck. So dogs that are going to have e-collars on for a longer period of time, like Gus initially, and you know, Gus even went home with a contact pad or a comfort pad mm-hmm. because he had to be shaved down, and so we want to make sure it's easy on his skin. So short-haired dogs are really good candidates, especially if they got to wear it for a long time.
Yep.
So order a comfort pad. You can get them from Ecollar, it's not Ecollar.
Ecollar.com.
You can order it from them, and then it's a real easy change to put it onto one of those mini educators, and then you can just leave it on the dog. Not, you can't just leave it on the dog, but you can leave it on the dog for a longer period of time without it causing neck irritation, which is something that you probably need.
Yeah, I was just thinking of something that ties this in, if you guys want to hear it. So when I used
I got it for you though.
Oh, you got it?
Let me groom you. There you go.
When I used to substitute for my mom's class, so my mom's pretty like, she you know, holds down the
fort
pretty well. Yeah. So when she used to, when I would substitute for her class earlier in the year, so what I would do is I'd go in like to visit her or whatever, and I'd see the class the way they were around with her there earlier in the year, and they were great because they had all the rules. They knew there were no options to be bad. They knew what was expected of them, all that stuff. So my mom was literally like the e-collar on them early on in the process.
Mm-hmm.
But then if I substituted early in the year, I would get a ton of pushback and a lot of stuff would happen, just like because they're naturally not those kids, you know, and not all of them, but just the ones that were. And then towards the end of the year, same thing. If I went into the class to visit and saw them, the kids were great around my mom. But then if I went into sub, they were great because they'd spent 9 months or whatever practicing with my mom. It's not like they needed my mom there all the time to be good, but by the end they had practiced it so much. They're like, oh, this
the
is just how we are.
Ingrained. Yeah. Yeah.
So it's kind of that same sort of thing.
Yeah. No, but that's a great, I love the whole teaching parallel with dog training stuff. So let me wrap up because I got really long-winded with that one. And that's get a comfort pad if you're going to have the e-collar on a lot so it's easier on the dog's neck. Still want to swap it around as often as possible, but it should make irritation much less.
Yep.
And then just leave it on. And so eventually you'll get your opportunities to correct. And if you don't get many opportunities to correct, you're still patterning the behavior. You're still moving the dog forward. The dog is still not practicing the negative behavior in the face of what would typically trigger that behavior. So I think you're cool. I think maybe you're concerned about that you're not getting any action to go after, but I think it's happening.
Yeah,
I think
you
it's
don't
happening.
Even realize it. Yeah.
Yeah. If we had a dog out in the kennel that came in like that's a maniac and is not a maniac, I'm not going to be worried. Like he's not being a maniac. I can't go out. I'd be like, yay, he's not a maniac.
He's giving it up.
So now we've got the beginning of new habits forming, and I think that's kind of where you're at if you'll keep that collar on. Cool. Thank you. Should we address this? Should we talk about your cleavage, the cleavage
debacle?
I don't
have any cleavage. So I was just looking back at the video and I was like, I've never had this issue. Like, I have friends that are like, oh my God, my boobs are coming out. And I'm like, good for you, because it's never happened to me. But I was just looking at the playback, and I may have been, it's not like showing anything, but there's like, you've got a downward angle.
Cleavage Jane.
Yeah. I'm literally wearing a workout outfit, but all right. You guys?
I think they're all grown-ups.
You guys are grown-ups?
Here's the thing. Those of you on the podcast, you're safe. You won't be offended. We won't get any.
Do we have to put an 18 plus on this?
We might. Yeah. So I'm going to take my shirt off in a second. So we'll just kind of go down the rabbit hole together. Ready?
I'll just sit up straight.
Hi.
That's literally the funniest thing, because I've never had that issue. So that's why it's like, why is this
happening to me?
I've never experienced this. All right.
Okay.
All right.
Let's move on.
Question number three. Keep my shoulders back.
What was it called? Like cleavage gate?
Cleavage gate. Yeah, exactly. I like that. We should put that up there.
Yep.
Question number three. This is from Alex Harris. Alex says, Sean and Laura, this is going to be long. That's okay. How do you handle a situation How do you handle a situation that involves owners having too much dog for them? Mm. These are clients who are nice people, but also work 12 to 14 hour shifts and are first time dog owners. They have seen how the dog can be as long as they can be, as long as they stick with the program, but they've gotten a bit lazy. They want the rewards of a balanced dog without the consistency. Mm. It's especially important for them to stay on track because their dog came to me for dog aggression and human reactivity. OMG. I have approached them with
that
the face, idea...
That response is so, like, worth $1 million.
What? Huh. Okay. I was just thinking about how, like, we all want that, right?
Right. It's just the ultimate cheesy human behavior of, yeah, I'd really like to be successful, but I really like laying in the pool.
Exactly.
You know, I just can't get to that email. It's
want
a
to
lot
lose
of work.
Weight, but... Boy,
those ice cream sandwiches are so tasty.
I've approached them with the idea of allowing me to find a more suitable dog for them, but they don't see the big picture and they aren't interested. I feel like my hands are tied at this point and I've just left it up to them. Mm. My main issue is just I know what will happen with this dog if they keep slipping, but also I've seen how awesome he can be with consistent leadership.
Yeah, that's a hard one. Alex has been a fan and followed us for a long
time.
Yeah,
Alex,
awesome. But this is one of those things I think we all have to deal with when we get into dog work is this kind of push-pull between what we know dogs are capable of and then what their lifestyle with their owners will actually allow them to achieve. And that can be a really hard one to reconcile. It can be a heartbreaking one. I think the longer you do the work, you don't become calloused about it. But you do recognize
See
the
it.
Reality of it, and you do have to, I don't know if gird yourself is the correct terminology, but you do have to protect yourself a little bit from that, because if you allow, I mean, there's that, you know, the saying of like, you can't want the success for the owner more than they want it themselves.
Yeah, just like anything in life.
Yeah, so... If you get caught up too much in it, not that we don't love the dogs or we love them any less, but you do, there is some self-preservation involved. And if you're not being conscious about like letting people own their responsibility, right? So you get hired as a professional to help them with their dog. You give them expert advice. You evaluate the dog. You get the dog trained. You see what the dog's capable of. And then the whole thing that if you watch the show or listen to our stuff, you know, we're always talking about teamwork. There's few things that are as teamwork oriented in this world as dog training. And so if your team is not on board, there's no way to win. I hate to put it so bluntly, but there's no way to win if your team's not on board, which is why we push so hard for trainers to be so selective about clients in order to be more successful, but also to avoid heartbreak and disappointment. Mm-hmm. There's nothing worse than putting your heart and soul into a dog and then seeing it go back to people that don't care. So I would say that you've got some people on your hands that, like Laura so astutely made a face at, that
I really didn't mean to make the face
no,
at them.
But it's,
I was just laughing. At
no,
like,
but it's an appropriate thing.
I was
thing.
Actually
like,
personally thinking about Hercules. How I would love him to be balanced without having to
yeah,
do any work.
But I mean, the first thing that I wrote down here is that they want the reward without the work.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I think both of us are pretty just as human beings, regardless of dog work, I think we're both pretty annoyed by that. Yeah. That state of mind's a pretty unfortunate
especially
place.
Especially when you put other people out, or you involve other people.
Or
into
dog, yeah, other people. Yeah, my dog might bite other people. My dog might bite other dogs,
I mean,
or something
selfish.
Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really selfish. So, but I think the important takeaway here, Alex, is that selfishness is going to go on, awesomeness is going to go on, and your job is to try and put yourself around as much awesomeness as possible, mm-hmm. and the least amount of selfishness as possible. Yeah. There's no perfect formula, there's no exact way to do this dance, but it's something that should be front of mind, that you should start to get more and more sensitive to make sure that you're putting yourself in the best place to succeed with the least amount of heartache. Now, that said, for actually talking to the owners, it sounds like you've already done a bit of that, but I mean, if it was us, we'd sit down and we'd say, like, yeah, it would just be all about honesty, about transparency. Like, okay, so here's your lifestyle. Here's what you guys are capable of. Here's what you're willing to do. Here's your dog. Here's his needs. Here's what his issues are like. And here's what's going to happen if he doesn't get these needs met and training and lifestyle adjusted. And then we have to put it in their court. It's their dog. And you have to say, so here's the reality. You're the expert. You give them the reality. You lay it out. And then you say, now you guys need to make choices based on this information I've shared with you. And you can't do anything, Alex, about what they're going to do with it. Mm-hmm. All you can do is lay it out. You can't pull them. You just got to say, here's the choices, and let them know ramifications. If your dog bites somebody, then you know, you're going to be responsible. If your dog does this, you're going to be responsible. And also let them know that there's a dog suffering. You know, forget about all the other things. There's just an unhappy dog in the mix that their selfishness is going to cause. So you can use that a little bit as leverage if you're really savvy about how you deliver it, about maybe trying to rehome the dog or something like that, and hey, I'll try and find you another dog that might be a better fit. Typically, we don't get a lot of that here, and I think a lot of that has to do with because we're really selective about clients. Not that we don't have dogs that are challenging for their owners, but I think that the owners that we get here are more committed to the process of doing whatever work it is to try and shore up that imbalance in the relationship. So, snoring nanny. Anything you want to add to this? Because it's such a...
Sometimes you just have to, unless they're totally out of your life and they're like, okay, here's your check, thank you, and you're gone. I think if you're still kind of in their life, sometimes you have to have, as a trainer, you are the doctor. So you sometimes have to have a more firm conversation than just kind of like a suggestion. I think you said that you have approached them with the idea of allowing, and that's bold within itself. So I know that you're not opposed to being bold. It's just a matter of if you're continuing to train for them. You know I've said to clients before, like, this is not going to work. You shouldn't pay me. It's actually, you should, this is bad that you're paying me because it's not working. And you're putting a dog at risk. You're putting people at risk. You're putting other dogs at risk because of this. And you can also reason with them, like, what would be a good expectation for you to live with during your life? Like, maybe the way that the training's set up, and I don't know your system, but maybe the way it looks is like too stringent for them. They're like, oh, I can't do this stuff, so I can't do any of it, you know? So
that's a good point.
So maybe sometimes...
Maybe simplifying.
Yeah, I find simplifying for clients that are like, wait, but whoa, I can't... I'd love to give this dog a good home, and I'd love to continue all this stuff. I'm guessing that's probably not the case, but I'm just trying to give the benefit of the doubt.
But it happens with a lot of dog trainers.
We can get it more in our own head. Like, come on, you got to do
prioritizing
this and this and this.
Like
and,
dog trainer.
And they're like, guess what? So there may be a way that you can be like, look, I really care about you as your trainer, but I can't have you pay me. It's not okay because this is not going to work. It's not good for the dog. What can I do to make it work? And if it's not, if, you know, you kind of talk human to human with them, and if they're good people, they're going to tell you, like, well, this is where it's at for us, and this is, and you know what, we just want to continue having the dog like this, and I'm sorry we brought you into this. Maybe that's the conversation they have, so can't do anything about that. But I would have a little bit of a firmer conversation and ask them the question, what can I do for you, you know?
Yeah, you hit on a really great point. I was going to try and build off of it, but I can't
remember
what it was.
No, I'm sorry. I kept going.
No. It was really good. Maybe it'll come back to me. But you were saying What did you just back up just a teeny
just
bit?
Just about it being too complicated. As
oh yeah, yeah, that's it. Thank you. So that's something we see a lot of dog trainers get caught up in, which mm-hmm. is like, here's my training, here's my protocols. I was just working with an owner just now, who's been training her dog prior to coming in here, and has a lot of different commands, right? And her dog's pretty highly trained. And so she's like, well, do I have to like, and I was like, no, if this command works for you, and if this works for you, I mean, we're looking for the net result, we're looking for the big stuff. If this works, that's great. We eliminate as many commands as we can. We try and make it so simple for people, because people have busy, complex lives, that we keep commands simple. We keep the actual, like, we don't say you got to do 45 minutes or half an hour a day. We don't say anything like that. Like, what we do say is that when your dog's out, your dog's working. But the cool thing about like passive training with a lot of duration work, which is really healthy for a dog, is that owners can do whatever the hell they're doing, yep. but the dog's in place, and that movement from the owner or real life going on around the dog from the owner is the training. And all they have to do is like kind of focus on their own stuff. So there's some ways, there's some workarounds with training to still get great value, get the dog still included, and then allow the owners to have enough breathing room to live a real life. And then you might even find that, like, when the pressure is relieved and they find, like, hey, the dog's actually pretty cool, not driving us crazy anymore, they might get more involved. They might actually find more time for it, because now it's more pleasurable rather than something that's a grind or, mm-hmm. you know, something like that. Yep. So hopefully that helps. And then I was gonna, the last thing I would just close with is really work on your diplomacy skills. Because even though Laura's saying have a firm conversation, there's ways to have a firm conversation that don't create defensiveness and keep a mind open and allow somebody to really hear you. And I'm sure that you'll roll with that. But like cultivating those skills about how you make somebody feel and how you jump into something that might be attention, you know, creating situation is you can shut people down instantly. Or if you say, let's talk about something that, you know,
it's been on my mind,
instead of, you know, you stuff, you make it more I messages, I think which is the typical kind of way of diffusing a lot of that. You know, I'm really feeling concerned about this, and
I don't want to take your money. I feel bad about this conversation.
I'm worried about the possible fallout. And then rather than you're doing this, which makes defensive stuff go on. So I'd roll with that. And this is a great learning experience for you as a trainer to find your way through. And also to remember what I said at the very top about why it's so important. I know when you're starting out, you're trying to grab every client pretty much, but why it's so important to work with people that are absolutely as dedicated as you are, or else you keep finding yourself in these heartache situations.
Cool.
Thanks, Alex.
Thanks. Okay, question number four. Sorry. Question number four is from Amber Scott.
Cleavage check.
Amber says, hi, Sean and Laura. I should blur it out.
You could blur it out. That would be great.
I'm going to blur it out. That's awesome.
That'd be great. Skull and crossbones.
Did you hear the beep I did in the last one? I was talking about Tori, and I was like, she's a badass dog trainer. Yeah, it was cool.
That was cool.
Okay.
We're getting fancy.
Yeah. Hi, Sean and Laura. This is Amber Scott. I'm having an issue with my new foster dog, who's a 95-pound American Bulldog pit mix. Mm-hmm. He's not aggressive at all, but he's a very rude greeter with other dogs. The first thing he wants to do is...
Jeff Gelman.
First thing he wants to do is mount them.
Oh,
that's not okay. Fortunately, my personal dogs are non-reactive. I've been able to properly socialize many dogs for the rescue, but this guy's very intense. Mm-hmm. He's been taught place, and I'm waiting for his e-collar to arrive. All my other dogs are e-collar trained as well.
Badassery.
Yeah.
Just the fact that all you guys are e-collar trained, and foster dogs coming through and getting the benefit of e-collar training. Man,
so cool.
This world, what is this world coming to? Good stuff.
Yep.
We're actually training dogs. It's so awesome. Amber, big ups to you for doing all this work and having all the dogs e-collar trained. Okay, so I'm going to try and keep this brief because I've been really long on the other ones. Two easy fixes. So if you're going to do the e-collar training, jump on that as soon as you get your collar, get the foundation work. I'm sure you already understand that, at least, because what we don't want to do is do any dog-to-dog interactions until the dog is very, very e-collar literate. So I would, do recall, sit, play some stuff like that, and make sure you get the dog super solid about what the collar means and that the collar comes from their behavior. And then once that's going on, boy, is it easy to correct for mounting and silliness. Once the dog is super solid with it, put him out with a crew of safe dogs that, you know, he's going to be like a dingbat with, mm-hmm. and then give him a little pop on the collar, start low and find the level, because you don't want to like blow his mind and have him like get panicky or weird and like start any, you know, escalate into a fight. Mm-hmm. But you do want to say, hey, knock it off. Yeah. And we get like, whatchamacallit was just like that, the star of the DVD show.
Magoo.
Magoo was terrible. Magoo was a bully. As sweet as he was a bully, and he would mount dogs and yep. just be a dingbat. I want to say jackass, but you'll have to bleep. And so e-collar work just like, boom, sorted, gone, right? So once you get to e-collar, a quick little tap, you don't even have to say anything. Just a quick little tap that's paired with the moment in time where the dog does the behavior at a low enough level starting out to where the dog's comfortable, he's already been conditioned, it'll be gone. Mm-hmm. Now, for dogs in the future, if you're doing any kind of foster stuff where you don't have the ability to do e-collar work, then we'll use a dressage whip. And just about anybody, any of the balance trainers I know out there that are doing socialization work, which is really where it came from. I think it came from Dick Russell in Louisiana, who was doing large field socialization, and he would use dressage whips as a way to kind of maneuver dogs around, but then also to correct like a pop on the rump if the dog was to escalate or do anything inappropriate. Mm-hmm. And now that's kind of like swept the dog training nation, and everybody uses dressage whips for socialization. It's hard to say. Socialization stuff. It's super effective, gives you a long reach. So you've got this dressage whip, dog goes up, goes to mount another dog, pop, dog goes, whoa, when I jump up to mount, that's uncomfortable.
Sucks.
And yeah, and you can reach 5 feet, however long you get your dressage whip. I'll have to pipe that in because I can't say it.
It's like dressage whip.
Overdub. Anytime you have to use a dressage whip, you then. anyway, so that's a quick fix for dogs that you don't have time to do e-collar work with, or you're not able to do e-collar work. Order a dressage whip from like Tractor Supply or something like that.
Amazon.
Amazon. They're good to have around the house for rowdy dogs too. Like, just you bring that out and you give a correction once in a while, and dogs are very respectful of a dressage whip.
Cool.
Anyways, I'm done.
Could it be?
Natasha Radovsky.
Radovsky. So question number 5 is from Natasha Radovsky, who you actually have a phone consult with tomorrow.
What?
Yes.
Say it ain't
so. I think Natasha's actually local.
Is she?
Did we meet Radovsky?
I don't think so.
I mean, could we?
Oh, could we?
I don't think so.
Oh, no. No, I'm very important. I'm very busy.
No. Radovsky's important and busy.
Oh, sorry. Yes. Sorry. Yes, then we can meet if she's got time for me.
She doesn't. All right, question number 5.
Right?
Hi, Sean and Laura. Thank you so much for everything you do. What would you recommend with a dog that redirects to a trainer owner in response of using a strong e-collar or prong collar correction? I mean, aside from using a muzzle, would you take this dog for your board and train? And if so, how would you assure that the dog who learns to respect you will automatically learn to respect others, not just the owners, but a vet, other trainers, etc.? So maybe you're talking
There's
to her about
no
this.
There's no such thing as automatically, right? So how do we get a dog to automatically respect others? We don't. The cool thing about dogs is that stuff, yes, you can generalize some of this, but there's a lot of stuff that's very relationship-centric. And dogs, if they can push somebody, they'll push somebody. And if somebody hasn't set a boundary for them, then they haven't set a boundary and they don't really respect them. So that's just something just to put in your pipe and smoke it. I guess I was going to say I can't come up with any like pleasant things like a stick in your craw, but that's not nice either. So Natasha, forget everything I just said, because you know what I mean. I'm hoping this will be helpful bit of information for you. As far as the board and train part of this, the question, what would we do? So for us, any kind of like serious behavior issues as far as like redirect, bites, anything like that, they're automatic board and train candidates. So I know trainers that will do this stuff out of one-on-ones, but we don't. So mm-hmm. the way our system is set up is we've got walk doctor, mini sessions, and one-on-one all with Brittany, and those go from 2 to 4 sessions, and those are all for like basic obedience, light reactivity, things like that, household stuff, all e-collar work. But like anytime we've got a serious customer, we need, in our opinion, we need to have that dog 24/7 so we can start to dissect what the problems are and really get into the dog's mindset. Because honestly, like working like an hour and a half at a time with a dog, when the dog comes from the home with the owner in his worst state of mind and you're trying to work with him, is the worst, most stressed out peak time to work with a dog and the most dangerous. Yeah. So if we're doing one-on-ones, we get rid of the owner. I mean that in a nice way, but we're like, we're gonna take the dog. So we get the dog away from the owner and then we start working the dog independent of the owner. So we get a little bit more of a neutral state of mind. But that said, if you're like I was just going to finish that thought, the one-on-ones, the reason we don't do them is because they tend to be more dangerous. If you've got a more dangerous, bitey, reactive mm-hmm. dog, what you want to do is get some leverage, and you get that leverage by getting him away from his owner, away from his home, mm-hmm. and away from his bad habits, and you get him into your board and train, and you control every single moment. Mm-hmm. And what that does is it starts to create some leverage. I get really choked up when I talk about leverage. That starts to create some leverage, which allows you then to start making some moves into that behavior without the dog being in the redirect, the taking umbrage with what you're doing, taking exception with what you're doing. So most of the time redirects, I have a pretty strong opinion about this. I was just talking with another trainer the other day, Nelson, 14-year-old Nelson, uh-huh. and he's really, I think 20, working with a heavy case, and we were talking about it. And I'm a firm believer that dogs actively make decisions, even in heavy redirect mode, about who to bite and who not to bite. Mm-hmm. I've seen it over and over and over again. Dogs that feel like, well, he can't help it. He's just over threshold. And then if he walks with me and I share a consequence that's valuable, he won't bite me. Mm-hmm. But I'll hand him to somebody else and he will. Somebody that might, like even with Laura, if she's got the same e-collar skills as I do, I can put her with a dog and the dog may not respect her as much. And even with the same skills, give her a harder time. Mm-hmm. So, hey, quick check-in. Uh-oh, we're out front. So okay. After this, we'll pick yep. up a doggy. Okay. So anyways, let me just wrap up here with the board and train section of this. So that's why board and train is so important for us. I can take a dangerous dog, get leverage, get him out of his power position, and start getting him into my power position and start chipping away at attitude, demeanor, perceptions of what he can and can't do. Yep. And then I slowly sneak in the back door. Next thing you know, I'm taking over and the dog is in a more softer, submissive, sweeter kind of mode. Mm-hmm. And then when I go out and I work on reactivity stuff, I've got a much gentler, more mild dog to deal with yep. typically. So that said, that's the board and train concept. Other than that, I would get him, I might consider getting him off of the prong collar and getting him onto a dominant dog collar. If you don't know what that is, go to learberg.com or look up if you're interested and then order a dominant dog collar or two. They're sized for the dog and they're basically a fitted slip collar. And I would use the e-collar and I would use the dominant dog collar. And like Laura's dog, Polar Bear, when she was dealing with reactivity stuff with him, that was their go-to because even having the prong collar on made him dicey. Mm-hmm. So the dominant dog collar takes away that sensation and possible association mm-hmm. or perception that the dog might have, because a lot of prong collar stuff can make dogs really get like amped up. So this goes for you, Natasha, or anybody else that's dealing with a reactive dog. Muzzle on. I prefer you do it in board and train. Dominant dog collar in case the dog does try and come up the leash. It's a very easy way to apply pressure and not increase the gas in the tank with the dog. Decrease it. Cause the dog to go, every time I do that, that's bad. It's uncomfortable. I don't like it. And you can be very relaxed and in control of the dog. So that's a big part of what I'd suggest. And then beyond that, I would take a good firm look at your distance, the space you're using between the dogs that you're addressing or walking by or whatever the triggers are for this dog. If you're moving, if you're too close, if you're way over threshold with this dog that like doesn't have it together yet, then that's going to be a situation where you're really fighting an uphill battle.
Okay, we've got question number 6. This is from Gregory Mard.
Yep.
Gregory says, good morning, Sean and Laura. I'm asking a question for my wife today. She started to watch the Good Dog Way DVD and she's loving it. However, she's still concerned about how snug she is, and I am, putting his prong on. We're using a 2.25 home springer with an extra link on a Dobie that has a long, smooth neck, and the collar tends to slide down. If we take out the extra link, you really cannot move the collar around his neck.
Yeah.
Please help us determine the best configuration in the situation. Thanks.
Gregory, the perennial prong collar.
if only there was a half size. Yeah. Yes.
So many people struggle with this. Yep. So oftentimes there's not a perfect fit. It's just the hard, cold reality of prong collar stuff. Like Laura said, people have asked for like half size links for forever, and there just aren't any. So what did I write down for you? If you can get the fit, right? If you can get the fit, right? The snug fit. So let's talk about the snug fit. Get the snug fit, and it keeps the collar up, and it doesn't slide down. And there's just light pressure, you know, pushing into the neck. It's not impaling the dog. It's not like this, but it's just light pressure. And owners can get funky about it because the prong looks so bad. Mm-hmm. And so they feel like dogs are so different than us, but they feel like if the dog's got this pressure, even like lightly, that it's uncomfortable and the dog's
right,
unhappy.
They can't move it around.
Yeah. And so I would say just to check in with that dogs are very different than us. And if there's a little bit of pressure, I wouldn't be so concerned about it. If it's loose, if you take that extra link out, you're going to have to constantly be moving the collar up, So if you can handle it up here, and the dog doesn't seem bothered, annoyed, or on edge because of it, which I highly doubt that the dog is, it's probably fine. Excuse me. Jeff Gelman has a saying that I think he uses it for e-collar and prong collar. What did he write? That if you think it's too tight, it's probably just right. So that's kind of his thing about it, because typically owners are a little bit more concerned about the pressure being too much because they're not familiar with the tools. And so my suspicion, Gregory, and it's hard for me to say conclusively without seeing it, you know, having your dog in front of me, but my suspicion is that if between sliding down or the next link out keeps it up, I can't imagine that it's this really intense, severe, like...
If you can't spin it, like, impossible to spin, then you might want to... You could maybe even go to... you go to a medium. You go to a medium collar, and you might get a different fit, the 3.0.
But because the links are different sizes.
Yeah, different sizes, so you may just get lucky. But the other thing is just if
it's also, like, how you spin it. Like, there's a lot of owners that have prong collars on their dogs that aren't snug. Yeah. And when they go to turn it, the way you actually hold the prong, a lot of them
the
put tension
sides,
on it.
Yeah.
And then the prong won't slide. Mm-hmm. And then I can easily take it and go.
Show us a video. Send us a video of it.
Yeah.
You know, if you are grabbing like where the chain is, where the ends of the, where the chain loops through those two pieces and you spin that way, I think we do it on the DVD. So I'm sure he's doing it right. But if just send us a video, we'll let you know.
Yeah. And my suspicion is that it's the most snug one is probably just right. Yeah. Send us a video and we'll give you an affirmation.
Or try the 3.0.
Yeah. Thanks.
Cool? Thanks. Question number 7. This is Megan Hawkins. Megan says, hi, Sean and Laura. I was late to the party last week, so I hope it's okay I repost this question
Never
as I really need help.
Our party.
Never too late. I have a 3-year-old Pitador named PJ that was a foster fail at 1 year, Labrador and Pit, probably. Oh. However, he's extremely high energy.
Stay on the job.
And when we get him out of his kennel, I make him wait, but when I tell him okay, he flies out of the kennel like he's on fire. We recently purchased a treadmill and we'll train him to that, but he's terrified of it. Thank you to you and Tyler Mudo for the amazing treadmill videos.
Hi, you're welcome.
However, I'm having a heck of a time wrangling his energy when he puts on his fear hat. He knows his basic commands will rock duration and wears an e-collar all the time. We have 4, so there's always one charged. He also barks at everything, blows his anal glands in public, and jumps the fence when left in the backyard, even with us and the pack with him. The list goes on forever. He's a multi-pronged issue, but I feel like I'm missing the boat and I could be doing something more for his anxiety and disquietly energy levels. Thanks, guys, and please give Manny a pat for me.
Manny. Easy. Talk about blowing anal glands. Exactly. Must be some soul connection.
Yes.
Manny's famous for that, too. Not out of fear, just out of disregard for humanity. Anyways, okay, so Megan Hawkins, this happens to be Laura's secret surprise question.
As soon as I was reading, I was like, this one's hard, so you can give it to me.
I haven't given you a hard one in a while, so, okay. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to assist you on this one, right? So okay. I've written up some notes, so I don't want you to feel left out in the cold, but it's a little more challenging one, because we've been throwing you some softballs.
Well, you have been throwing me softballs. Yeah. The thing is that, let's see. He knows all his basic commands, will rock duration, he barks at everything.
I love this.
So if he barks at everything, I mean, I hope you're correcting that on the e-collar. Jumps the fence, that needs, you know, my guess is he needs just needs to be locked down. That's not just my answer to everything, contrary to popular belief. But
Morgan, lockdown? You don't need to read this. It's just messages coming in from other people.
So I thought it was her outfit. So I would say that you've got a lockdown, like just the fact, just the little clues in here that he's in the backyard where he can be jumping over the fence, right? Or if he's barking at everything, like that just sounds like maybe there's a little bit of looseness. So
what? Explain your lockdown.
So the lockdown is this, Megan. You have to, when he's out now, because you're kind of in training period, you're kind of renegotiating things with him. Mm-hmm. When he's out, he is either in command, so he's in place command, he's in the down, he's in some command reinforced by the e-collar, so he can't get up and walk to another place command, he can't follow you upstairs unless you ask him. So that's command, or he's on a walk, or he's in the crate. So, or a little bit of playtime if you're supervising and he's not doing any fence fighting or anything like that. So you have four options. Supervised playtime, which should be like not the majority of his day. Command, which should be the majority of his day. Crate time, which should be if you're gone, you guys are sleeping, or if you just need to be out of dog world, or he's on a structured walk with you. So those should be your four options right now with your guy, especially because he's just anxious in so many areas. You need to kind of lock down and do a boot camp with him because you've got all the other things on board.
Explain to them why the freedom and the movement. Not that she might not be doing a good job of it, but why for everybody else, why the freedom and the movement is counterproductive.
Freedom and the movement is just options for a dog who is prone to anxiety. So the more options he has, the more anxious he's going to become, the more you're going to see other things come out. Guarantee you, if you continue the way that things are right now, which seems like it's a little loose, even though you are doing great, most likely in 2 weeks, you'll give us three more things to add to the list, and then three more things. And oh, now he doesn't like this type of person. It's just... Just like humans, just like ripples anything. Out. Yeah, it just keeps going. So I would just nip it in the bud by, you've done all this great work. Now let's lock him down completely. Take away the options, make it non-negotiable, and watch him just relax. And do that now for a month.
Man, spoken like a true...
Parrot?
No, like a true... I mean, just that. What she just said is so awesome. She does a lot of, or used to do a lot of the talking to the clients on the phone. So you've got that, like, you can really explain that so well because you've spent so much time doing it. But what you just said is so, like, right on the money. Oh, cool. So what Laura said, like, boom, her secret surprise question. She, like, threw the pitch and boom, over the fence.
Yep.
The only thing I'd add to that is that everything she said was wrong. Sorry. No. The only thing I'd add to that is that the dog's on e-collar too, is that you might need, and this is going to like fly counter to what a lot of people would suggest, and a lot of people that might watch this might be aghast, and we might get like people burning, you know, like torches out in front of the house. But with fearful dogs, a lot of times the fear level and anxiety level is so high that you actually need higher level corrections to combat and create buy-in or override that fear. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but... If we've got a dog that's like fearful about the crate or fearful about place or fearful about staying in place when there's people moving around or whatever it is, the fear is taking precedence, right? So the fear is at this high level and the dog's panicking, fight or flight, just wants to get out. But once you start training and using pressure with Ecollar, then you can start using the Ecollar to trump that fear, right? Mm-hmm. So the fear's here, and if your corrections are here, then the fear always wins, and so this is all that gets listened to. But if your corrections can come up higher, you can actually override this fear mm-hmm. and get the dog to buy in, which is super counter for what most people think, because you got a fearful dog, you're correcting it, you're going to make it more nervous, more anxious, more freaked out. The truth is, that's already happening. Mm-hmm. The fearful, anxious, freaked out part, you got it. It's on the menu. It's already been ordered. It's already there. What we're talking about is blocking or breaking that cycle mm-hmm. of that stuff. And sometimes just higher pressure is the answer to get in there. Now, it doesn't mean corrections are the way to go to make everything perfect. But when you've got a dog that's cycling stuck in a thing, it can be an amazing transformative moment where you use enough pressure to say, I know you want to break place because you're freaked out, but I'm going to correct you firm enough to where you prioritize what I'm asking you for, which gives that dog the first moment in time to actually buy into what you're asking for and prioritize what you're looking for rather than the fear. And that's when you start to see things change. And I think, to be perfectly frank, why we get so much transformation with heavy-duty dogs here is because we understand that concept and we know how to balance it really nicely with very soft, gentle stuff as well. But when dogs are in a peak, accelerated aroused state, we also understand very clearly how to push through that arousal and help a dog actually come back down to planet Earth. And what we're really looking for is listen to the training, listen to us, don't listen to the fear, don't listen to the anxiety, don't listen to the freak out. And the only way that happens is if the volume of your conversation or communication is louder than the fear. Yeah. If the fear's up here, none of the training gets heard. Mm-hmm. If the communication or the correction or the training is up here and the fear's here, it gets heard and it gets prioritized. I hope that makes sense, because that might be the best thing I've said all show.
Go on.
Nice tag team on that
teamwork.
One. Good work.
Okay, guys. We've got question number 8. This is from Ashley Smith. She says, hi again, Sean and Laura. My update was probably perhaps premature. Hank, the coonhound, does better in his crate, but when routines change, like when I was homesick for the
Hank,
two...
Hank, it's a perfect name for a coonhound, by
yeah.
the way.
When I was homesick for 2 days this week and then went back to work, he's now barking in the crate. Mm-hmm. My neighbor informed me he barked from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. almost nonstop last week. He seems to be collar-wise because I can't use the e-collar while I'm at work, too far away, and I don't like leaving collars on in his wire crate. You know, she knew of someone who got...
Yeah, read that part because it's important to my answer.
I know personally of one owner that had their dog strangle and die with a collar on trying to jump a baby gate, so I'm really hesitant to leave something like a bark collar on if he gets excited and it gets stuck in the crate wires while I'm at work. Any advice?
Okay, cool. So, Ashley Smith, I would absolutely, unequivocally, without a doubt, with no reservations, use a bark collar. Mm-hmm. There's no way you're going to be able to curb this behavior. You're going to end up being the enemy of your neighborhood, or your neighbors are all going to hate you. And your coonhound is also going to be a stressed out wreck and a mess. So I would absolutely get a bark collar. I would say go with either the sport dog right now or the Dogtra. And you can order, I think, either of those off of Amazon.
Yeah.
We're using the sport dog more than anything right now, and it seems to be pretty simple. Don't use the sport dog on the auto escalation setting. Use it on just the setting where you start at like 1 and then the next day start at 2 and move from there nice and slow. Here's the thing. We leave bark collars and e-collars and regular collars on dogs all the time. We've never had an incident of a dog getting caught, strangled, something like that. And the reason being is the story, although a very sad story from the friend that you knew, chances are that was some kind of a looser collar, because a bark collar's fit very snug. Mm-hmm. And there's no chance, jumping a gate or a fence or something else, that's a very different story, right? Yep. There's more possibilities for problem. In a crate, there's nothing really to get hooked onto. And a bark collar that's fit snug, there's no way to get anything under there. I've never seen it. I'm not saying it's never happened in the world of dog owning.
Yeah.
But boy, I know a lot of dog trainers, and I know I'm on a lot of training forums, and I've never heard a bark collar getting stuck. Someone can correct me if I'm wrong. I'm sure there's somebody out there that's like, yeah, I've seen it. But boy, those chances are super duper remote. Hey, let there be light. And getting dark in here.
Keep going.
So anyways, let's go.
That's better.
You're getting a multitude of lighting looks. So I would heartily suggest that you let go of that fear of the strangulation. Yeah. We have bark collars on all the dogs that are in here that need them, or e-collars. Never had a problem. Not going to get caught in the crate, and it's going to be snug, and you're going to be fine, and your dog will actually stop barking and will be a more comfortable dog. That's my answer to that. Hopefully that helps. I got to go put this guy back.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. Question number 9, this is Tara Isaacson. She says, hey guys, mostly doing great with Scout my pit mix.
That's a funny story.
Was at good canine good citizen test Saturday with our trainer. She passed with flying colors, but as others were being tested, had an incident where another dog about 10 feet away went after another dog also 10 feet away, so she tried to jump into the fray. I corrected quickly, fortunately was back on our prong and e-collar, and our CGC privileges were revoked. Fair enough. I'm not concerned about her test, just her behavior. How do I make her believe that I've got it handled? I'm seeing 90% improvement with all your protocols, but frustrated she didn't keep her cool. She will clearly never be a golden retriever. much thanks.
Okay, cool. Tara, so much of this is about long game stuff. So much of this is about, like, you know, we see all the owners that succeed that send us updates. It's all about just constant dedication and chipping away daily. So much of this is like, I wish I could fast forward. If you really do hard work for the next 6 months to a year, I wish you could fast forward and then have that direct contrast of what your dog looks like in that time.
Yeah.
You'll see dramatically different results.
Yeah.
So such a big part of dog training. Yes, there can be some transformations that happen pretty speedily, but the big stuff typically, like what you're describing with your dog, I mean, so many of these pitties have arousal issues. And they struggle with when they see a fracas, you know, they see, or a fracas, and they see
a fracas,
or they see, you know, a little dog squabble or something like that. So you've got genetics, DNA, arousal stuff. A lot of these pitties can program with it. They see that stuff and they get really juiced up. And that's a hard thing to work against, but you can work against it. Mm-hmm. So my recommendation to you is to not be disheartened by that and to instead just be reheartened,
mm-hmm.
and which is not a word, and just go out and just...
Oh, but get reinvigorated.
Resolute, like, just teeny, tiny, imperceptible, awesome steps every day will get you better and your dog better. And eventually you'll get to a place where you'll be surprised where you're at, but it'll only be upon reflection that you'll notice it. No, I've got a pity over your grumbling. So don't let that bum you out. Any of these guys that are these pitties that we see that come in with arousal issues, it really is a war of attrition. You just have to go out and you got to work it. And you said, when is he going to believe I've got it? It's going to take time. It's like any kind of like renegotiating of a relationship takes time, especially if he's seen it be different for a while. You got to build that back and build that back. And as your skills take time too. So your dog's getting trained, but you're getting trained. And as you get better, he starts to mirror that and get better as well. So that's my suggestion is don't lose heart over this.
Yep.
And I mean, if you want to jump in and add anything,
I think
it's a long game.
It is long game. Like, I don't remember how long you've been working with Scout with our stuff, but all I can say, you've been doing an awesome job. Just the fact that she just got a little like, whoa, what's that? You know,
that's so like not a big
so
deal.
Typical. And yeah, of course your CGC got revoked. It's like, come on guys, like whatever. But I think she probably trusts Heath.
So many great dogs would have the same reaction.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Belle would probably get...
No, not Belle. But like...
No, but she would probably be like,
Manny would
going
get
on?
Like Manny or like Golden Dude and Hercules. They would both get like...
Yeah.
You know, worked up. I mean, they may not bark and get frenzied, but they get worked up. It's dog stuff, especially pity stuff.
But just getting ready for those moments, if they do happen, and just like you did, correcting, that's how she's going to know.
Yep.
So that's it.
Be ready for it and correct it firmly and get it gone and just keep working every day. So that is our recommendation to you, Miss Tara, and I think you're doing awesome.
Yeah, we love you. Okay, question number 10. This one's going to be the quickest one ever. Or is it? Hi, Lauren, Sean. A quick but peculiar question.
This is from...
B.L. Spillane. My lab, Savoy, who I think you may remember from previous questions, has just recently gotten freaked out by my iPhone's text message notification sound. I changed it to a very different sound and he was okay, but in a week he was right back to trying to run away from it. Should I try some counter-conditioning protocols, giving him treats and food while playing the sound to see if I can change his fear towards it? Thank you always, Betsy.
Thanks, Betsy. Okay, Mr. Savoy. So we had a situation. We had a, I don't know if you remember the couple who had a problem with the dog.
Yep, with the iPhone. Computer song. Yep.
And
What's her face? Sandy or whatever.
Yeah, I can't remember. But we've had lots of dogs like Belle. I'll tell you a really quick story. So Belle, my girl, has issues with smoke detectors because she had some really bad experiences early on and like broke out, panic attack, broke teeth, got impaled on nails, really horrible stuff. And so what she managed to do is pair the oven, which would smoke if somebody would reheat pizza without aluminum foil under it.
Why are you saying, looking at me?
I'm just sharing with you my dirty secret.
Yep.
And that would set off the smoke detector. So being the smart girl that she is, anytime you went near the oven, she would convulse, shake, panic, eyes wide, quiver, and be a wreck for an hour and a half. So what did I do? Same thing happened with the microwave. And so what we do is we put her very favorite thing, which are balls. Like if you were to be able to look over here in the kitchen, you'd find four or five of her favorite balls in the oven. And in New Orleans, I put them in the oven and the microwave because she hasn't gotten totally desensitized to the microwave. But now here, you go to the oven, what does she do?
So excited.
Yeah. So that's counter conditioning, right? So what I'd say for your guy, for Savoy, is pair all sorts of anything that Savoy likes with that sound, right? Mm-hmm. So make that sound a predictor, right? Hit the sound and then food. As long as, like, if the dog freaks about the sound, then you might have to have that sound quieter, more at a distance. No. Quieter and more at a distance to do it a little bit softer to where it's not overwhelming. But the whole point is to make that sound, instead of predicting panic, make it predict something really great. So I would say, like, food, high value treats, the leash, right? If I'm gonna go like if I'm gonna walk Savoy, I'm gonna go bink, and then I'm gonna pull out the leash, right? And I'm gonna feed him, I'm gonna go bink, and then I'm gonna start pouring the food. And then before I put the leash on him, or before I head out the door to even walk, maybe put him at the threshold, put him in a sit, bink, let's go. Yep. And you just keep pairing all these things, so all of them become predictors. All the things that, like, you know what he likes the most. If it's a ball, whatever it is, then definitely do that. Sorry, I'm having to correct. No. So that's the recommendation, and it works really well, but you have to be consistent, and you just have to be on the ball as far as what exactly your dog likes the most. Now, if it's really severe stuff, this is what I'll wrap up with. I promise I'm not going long. But if it's really severe, then only feed Savoy when you do this. Yeah. And that's how you build some real leverage. If the dog is really hungry, like, treats may not have enough magic, but if you only feed and you give, like, bink, you give him a chance to eat, and he doesn't, then food goes away. Then you come back at night, bink, here's the food, he's night. Food goes away, start the next day, bink, and eventually, Savoy's going to be like, man, I'm hungry, and then get into it, and then that will become a predictor of food, and the emotional connection will be a positive and high one. Yep. So that is my very short answer to your question.
You're awesome.
And thanks, I'm trying. I have so much I want to share. I just want to share.
It's just we have this every week, and we're going to start doing ones in between, but we have to keep our audience, so we can't make it 2 hours long.
All I can picture is that meme where it's the skeleton on the bus bench or on the park bench, and he's like, I'm already dead.
Yeah, exactly.
Is the show over is when we should send out. Anyways, guys, okay, so quick thing just to wrap up. As a recommendation, I know people like book recommendations.
Yeah,
we talked
about that.
A book I'm really crazy about right now, who's actually written by a very young guy, which freaks me out that he's that wise and has written more books than I have. I'm very pissed off about that. Ryan Holiday, who was actually the marketer for American Apparel and several other big authors and things like that. He's a young guy. I think he's like 25 years old, something like that. But he's got a book called The Obstacle is the Way. Mm-hmm. And Belle, no. And it's a really fabulous book. Sorry, we've got a dog, aggressive dog over there, so I can't let our other guys go there. Really awesome book. I think you listened to the audio, didn't you? Mm-hmm. And I'm almost done with it. But, you know, like I wrote a couple notes about it, that it's basically about how reframing your view on problems or obstacles creates internal power, forces creativity, and reduces stress. And those are really like some majorly truisms about it, because obstacles oftentimes get viewed as this thing with all this resistance.
Yeah.
When in fact, if you reframe them, and it's not about a Pollyanna thing about like everything is going to be great. It's about really looking at like, what does this obstacle, this challenge create in me? What mm-hmm. what do I have? What skills do I have to develop? What internal skills, external skills? What do I have to get better at? What am I going to gain from working out this problem mm-hmm. and solving this? What? How is it going to force me to think differently than I'm already thinking? And what gifts am I going to get from it? I'm a big fan. Darren Hardy was the first one that really turned me on to this, but I'm a big fan of your obstacle being your gift. Mm-hmm. That the reason that you can do special stuff, typically, people that are doing really special things have typically been through some really heavy duty stuff. Mm-hmm. And so you want to call them obstacles or challenges. I mean, you look at Oprah Winfrey's like early experiences. I mean, they're like so horrendously awful, but what's it allowed her to do as a human being is, mm-hmm. is phenomenal. It's just one example. But I think changing the way you view obstacles and challenges mm-hmm. can be such an amazing, empowering transition and way to reframe life.
Yeah.
And the book's been really valuable, and it's just short, quick read.
It's almost like if you can't beat them, join them. You know, it's like if your obstacle, if you're constantly against it all the time, and obviously there's terrible things that can happen to mm-hmm. you that you can do nothing about, but it's like,
how do you choose to do that?
How are you going to take that? Yeah. Are you going to just roll over with it? Which can happen, which sometimes you need to do for a while to heal or whatever you need to do. But then being like, all right, this happened. How am I going to use it? You know?
And every time something bad is something bad, and I really love like air quoting that,
yeah, yeah.
because every time something that I perceived as bad happening to me or that I've really resisted or been worried about, once it's been resolved and done, it's been the best thing that's ever yep. happened to me, without question.
Yep.
As long as you're looking for where's the best part of this.
Exactly.
If you're looking for where the misery and the pain and the struggle and the suffering, then you're going to find that. But I think it's a really short, powerful, awesome book
yeah.
for anybody that's looking to reframe how they move through life in a more powerful fashion
yep.
rather than being beat down by, I mean, quick little tip, you ain't ever going to get away from challenges and obstacles. Mm-hmm. All life is just a series of them. Mm-hmm. So you might as well choose to view them in a way that empowers you
yep.
and helps you to enjoy your life at a higher level.
Yep.
What do you think about that? Them
love
apples.
It.
You like it?
We love
guys, you guys. We'll see you. This is our first 3-hour show. We're gonna do this as a mini series, actually. Can I give you a high five?
High five.
Nice work. Nicely done. Nicely done. We'll have to like blur out the cleavage cam. And guys, thanks so much for watching. And hope you enjoy the new format and the new mics and the new goodness
yeah.
and all that.
Keep
we got lights coming, like we
stuff.
Said.
Yeah,
right? We're
up.
Gonna get prettier.
Yeah, we have to. It's necessary.
All right. Either that or models are coming in
yeah.
to replace us.
Thanks, right. guys.
See ya.
Bye.
Take care.